All right. Shalom, saints. Greetings to all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I believe every one of you is ready for the service now. As you are logging in, may the Lord bless you. May you receive a blessing wherever you are. Because every time when we come for service, we are serviced, and there is something that impacts in our life that God gives. Today, of course, I'm only a bit tired. You know, I was overworking at the surgery. But there is a way of changing gear from the natural to the spiritual surgery. And I'm excited that tomorrow I'll be preparing to go to Yeovil, South Africa, where we'll be preaching in South Africa. They'll be taking a subject about the greatest vindications of this message that are continuing now. The vindications of this message. So I'll be happy to see our brothers in South Africa. I noticed some of them will be traveling from different places, and some of them, I'll be seeing them for the first time. Pray for the services. I'm hoping to be landing in South Africa tomorrow, as you support in prayers. Now, we're going to open our Bibles as we welcome all those who are coming in, those who are coming online and enjoying the service. We say today we'll be preaching about the purpose of the message of the hour. Because when God sent this message, there was a purpose, there was a target person, and there was a preparation that he wanted to do to us. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 1, verse 5, "This then is the message which you have heard from him and declare to you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all." Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, you are the Father of lights. Your every good gift comes from you, Lord Father. And I pray that as we are preaching this message, this then is the message. Let the light of life shine across the light of everyone, O Lord Father. May the light strike the seed that was predestinated. Those who are meeting circumstances, O Lord Father, may it be like you said in the Bible, that those that sat in the region of the shadow of death, they saw a light springing forth. May they say, Lord Father, this message coming to meet the end time conditions, may the reality of this word, the reality of the power of God, be proven in our lives, Father, as we see the God of the Bible coming into present tense, and the God of the message saying, "As I was with Moses, so shall I be with you. As he was with the prophet, so shall he be with us." Father, may we see you present tense today, Lord Father, attending to every need. By your word, Lord Father, we crush every power of the enemy that rises against the preaching of your word. Father, may you come and forgive the sinners, Lord Father, heal the sick, Father, and save the lost. We commit the service into your hands in Jesus' name. Amen. Yes, here the Bible is saying, "This then is the message." There's always an argument of what is the message. And people say, "Oh, brother, this is no longer the message." But what is the message? And what was the message sent for? The Bible says, "This then is the message." When the prophet is preaching, he says, "Not one time did I send a message to the people that they may follow me or join a church or organization." He has no interest in that. But he says, this one thing he does, that to see an established a true spiritual relationship between God and man, wherein men become new creations in Christ, filled with the Holy Spirit, and live according to the word. So this is what the message is about, to bring us to become powerhouses, living episodes, to be an engine room of the gospel, to be God on 2 feet, walking in you, talking in you, living in you, reflecting the life of Christ. The end time message is to get the bride ready and prepare for the rapture. So the message is preparing, because there's going to be a meeting in the air, and the message is sent to prepare us. And every day we must be getting closer and closer to perfection, because he says, "Be ye perfect as even as he is perfect." So Jesus is coming for a bride without spot or wrinkle. In Malachi 4, it says, "I will restore the hearts of the children back to the fathers." So the message, through the divinely revealed mystery truths, will literally turn the hearts of the children to the fathers, and wind up all the mysteries of the Bible, and bring the mystery of God. There's always a mystery that surrounded God, but the message brings up that mystery. It says that the Son of Righteousness shall rise with healing in its wings. So that's why you see the healing campaigns. God has never, the Bible has never had a time where the message has been so vindicated as this message that we are having now, where God is pouring all what was in him to empower his children in this crucial hour, in this last hour, in the climax of the redemption story, when the devil is also pouring his power to empower his children in the last climax of the period. But the Bible says that you, to you that know my name, the Son of Righteousness shall rise with healing in his wings, and you shall go out and grow fat like the calves of the stall. So we have so much food, spiritual food in due season. We will be fed. There's no time need to borrow food from other maybe denominational preachers and things. But we have so much food in the message, spiritual food in due season, that let your soul delight itself in fatness. That is the equal food. The message of the hour is the equal food. The prophet was told, store the food. So the food is stored in tabs, in tablets, in like Moses said, tablets. We now have tablets also of the message, so that you eat the food, because there is coming a famine when the churches will be closed. But now we have the message, the, with the wheat of the time. This is the combined harvest. The wheat is ready, the harvest is plenty. Even in Joel 2 verse 24, there it says, thy floors shall be full of wheat, and thy vats shall overflow with wine and oil. So this is a plenteous time. It's the harvest time. This is the time where you have to be ready in the stage of a perfect man, ready for the harvest, because the sickle is laid now. So because the wheat shall be plenty, and the floors shall overflow. You should overflow with testimonies, overflow with the goodness of God. So the voice of God spoke to the prophet that this is the king's sword, not a king's sword. So the king's sword is now in the bride. It means we are royal, because we are carrying the royal seat. The message is a sword to cut the devil, to overcome all challenges, and to live the holy life, is to bring back holiness to the people of God. The message is the Holy Spirit taking the word of God and giving it out to you. So the Holy Spirit knows what you need for today. He knows the scripture that you must hear today. He knows the quote that you must hear today, because the message has introduced us to him. It says he is here, and he will never leave us. He will be with us until the perfection of the redemption story. When our bodies are changed, what we bypassed, our theophanies, will unbypass them. And there's going to be a change of our bodies. This is the message for a body change. And the angel of the Lord accompanies the message always. Wherever the message is preached in its purity, the signs and wonders follow. The supernatural is seen. The third pool manifestation is seen. And the God of the message is there, looking and keeping the message. And when you meet that God of the Bible, when you meet the God of the message, men cannot meet God and talk with God and ever remain the same again. When you hear from God, when you meet God, when he visits you, something is permanently changed in you. Your desires are changed, your appetites are changed, your nature is changed, your dressing is changed, your music is changed, your sources of influence, your association, your ambitions, everything around you is changed, because you have met the God of the Bible. God has never sent a message in any day but what he vindicated with the supernatural. So every sermon must not be empty. The word should not return void, but it should accomplish that it was sent to accomplish. So this message was not sent so that we become big and we say we are bigger than Pentecostals, we are the eagles, they are the chickens. It's to make us humble. The message is not sent to have a pastor who will say all other pastors are lost. The message is a message of love. It's sent to show us perfect love, because without perfect love, no one will make it to that place. So the prophet was baptizing the 17th person on June chapter 11, and we are now right in June again, on Ohio 1933, and the star appeared, the light, because the message is light. It says, as John the Baptist was sent to forerun the first coming of Christ, this message will forerun the second coming of Christ. And the prophet quickly confesses that, I may not do it, but this message will introduce Jesus Christ to the world. For as John the Baptist was sent to forerun the first coming of Christ, this one will forerun the second coming. And already we are in the rapture process. We are already in the process of the coming of the Lord. So this message is to make you a spiritual powerhouse. You are not supposed to be a pest house, but you should be loaded with the spiritual explosive that the devil cannot touch you. It should be a 1,000, 10,000, million volts lines that the devil cannot touch you, because you are anointed, you are equipped, you are full of the power of the message, of the power of the presence of God. The message of the hour is a sign to the churches. It is a sign to the people. It is a true sign that is overlooked, and there are not enough critics to silence it. There is no enough challenges and opposition to silence it. Against all odds, God watches his message and he watches the believers, and he will see you through, and he's going to vindicate everyone that believes the truth. And the purpose of the Bible, the purpose of the message is to reveal God. So Christ is the principal theme of the message. The message is not about do's and don'ts only, but when you have the message, when you have the Holy Spirit in you, because the message of the message is the Holy Spirit. It's the token, it's the anointing, it's the power, it's the supernatural. When you now have that Holy Spirit, it will make you overcome. It will make you have the power to stand against all odds, to stand against powers of the enemy. The seventh angel's message is to open the mystery of the seals, calling the 11th hour Gentile worker to receive the same pay as the first worker gets. So the message is the raising of a standard. There is a generational impact. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of God will raise a standard against the enemy. So there is a standard of living, a standard of praying, a standard of the anointing, a standard of virtues, a standard of testimonies, levels in the supernatural that we get into when we believe the message. So the message of the hour, it will give you the victories. It's linked to the supernatural. The message of the hour is the ark, like the word of God is the ark. As they entered the ark in the Noah's day, and they were saved. If you enter the word, if you enter the token, if you enter the revealed mystery truths of the time, if you enter the token of the word, you are saved. You can raise him from history, and you see God every day, every hour in your life, because he is faithful. He that has promised will never leave you, but he is faithful to keep everything that he has promised. So the message of the hour is to bring again the Bible days. We are back in the days of the Bible. We are back in the days where you see red letters, Christ speaking in the sermon in red letters, Christ speaking in songs in red letters, Christ speaking in your prayers, interceding with groanings that cannot be uttered by men. So the message empowers us. It equips us to run in this race. Sometimes you are feeling so tired. You are coming from work. Sometimes you are discouraged. Sometimes all hell is assailing you. But when you get home then, you switch on the tape and you hear that, good evening, friends, let's open our Bible. There is a refreshing something that energizes you, because this is the message of our time. It is the final voice. We under this messenger, in the message of the hour, we are the final voice to the final age. The devil has no final voice in the affairs of your life, but God is the final voice in the affairs of your life. So we are glad that God sent a wise man. Wise master builder and a messenger who were to store the food, because the hours were coming when there's a spiritual famine. Hour was coming when people are going to deviate. But he says, stay in line, stay with the message. Don't inject your thoughts. Say what the tape says. And they had to say, store the food. When you saw the mountain of the bread of life. So you cannot be malnourished when you are in the message where there is plenty. Our floors are overflowing with wheat and with the oil. Now, the same oath is there today of the token. The same thing. It will not let you perish with them that don't believe the message. When you believe the message, don't perish with the outside world. When you are in the ark, don't perish with the outside world. Take the message into your heart. And then you must have the token. The very life that was in Christ be in you. When I see the blood, when I see that life, I'll pass over you. So the message is a filter. You always check your motives and your objectives according to the word of God. If it isn't, you leave it alone. Whatever you are doing, check it with the filter of the word of God. Filter your thoughts. Filter your ideas. Filter your deals. Filter even your dreams. Filter even your attitudes by the word of God. So the message of the hour is to activate the promise of the hour. All scriptures promise for this hour, we can say this day, this scripture is fulfilled in our ears. So as he was with Moses, he was with Joshua. As he was with David, he was with the mighty men of David. As he was with Elijah, he was with Elisha. As he was with the prophet, the same supernatural life that was there must be seen as the supernatural life of the bride. But God is going to take us to the threshing floor. He's going to beat us with the hammer of the gospel until the life of Christ is reflecting in us. He's going to beat us with the hammer of the gospel until all dross, all the natures of sin are taken away. Then we reach an hour when we are standing in the purity of the message. The hour is coming when the world will shake under the impact of the Church of the Living God, when it's moving forward in great power. That's right. I hope to see it in my generation, and it's already started. Every promise is already with us now. So the message will never become a denomination. You can become a denomination, but the message will never be a denomination. So all what you need in your old earthly journey is in you and you have the Holy Spirit. And it's in the books, it's in the tapes, the way of doing our hair, the way of dressing, the way of our life is already written. So the message introduces you to yourself, working in your spiritual DNA. So we didn't know ourselves, like the boy who sees himself in the mirror and says, "Mama, that's me." It means that you are seeing yourself in the Bible. You are seeing what you ought to be conditioned, and every day you are growing as the inner man is renewed and you are being changed from glory to glory. Spiritual amnesia is vanishing because of the message, because of the revelation of the hour. The revelation of the hour will break the deception of the hour. So the end time message will meet the end time conditions. So it's there too. When there are conditions, this message is a warning light. And it's going to stand and overcome the end time condition, whatever condition you have in your life. The preaching of the gospel will meet that condition. If you are suffering depression, the gospel will swallow away that depression. If you are facing rejection, the gospel will bring acceptance to you. If you are sick, the gospel will heal you. If you are rejected and if you are lost, the gospel will bring salvation to you. If you don't know which way to take, the gospel will show you the footprints to follow. So we have the influence that cannot be opposed. Like in Job 38, it says, "Who can bind the sweet influence of the seven stars of Pleiades?" So we are under the influence, not of alcohol, not of drugs, but we have the opium of the word of God. We are drunk with the word of God, and a drunk man, you know, is not caring about this life. Is high. So in the spirit we are always high, we cannot be low. So this message is a message of restoration. The purpose is to restore the original word. What the palm worm, locust and caterpillar and cankerworm, what all those forces of evil came and ate away from the church, God cries in Joel 2 there that I will restore the original word, the original seed, the original powers, such that the same power that opened the Red Sea will be in your life. The same anointing that spoke things into existence will be continuing in your life. It's a restoration of everything, even the years that were lost. God can restore what has been taken away from your life. He can bring it back even in abundance. So the message is deep. So you must dig deeper in the treasures of God. The message is deep. You must read the church edges. You must read the seals. You must read all the mysteries, 7 weeks of Daniel. You must, you know, even after the seals, the prophets kept bringing more prophetic messages, the token and all these messages, maybe broken systems and all the messages, marriage and divorce. And it's rich, it's honey in the rock, my brother, because in the book of Revelation there, chapter 14, we see an angel with an everlasting gospel. So the message has eternal validity. In other words, the message is not only valid in this earthly life, even in heaven, the word of God is holding the heavens. Our lifestyle in heaven is about the message. The way they are in heaven, we are living according to the heavenly pattern. So the message is a continuation of the book of Acts. The same power that was in the book of Acts. If they cast out devils, we are casting devils. If they spoke in tongues, we are speaking in tongues. If they have the gift of the Spirit, we have the gifts of the Spirit. If they were baptizing in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we are baptizing in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. If they had special miracles, we have special miracles. If they had angelic visitations, we have angelic visitations. That's why the Bible says, I will ride the trail once more. There must be a continuation. This message does not stop with the going of the messenger, because the same equal cherubim, the same anointing of God, the same angel of the Lord, the same pillar of fire, the same Holy Spirit is continuing descending, continuing doing the miraculous. Now, it's light time coming for believers, but it's gross darkness to the people. Outside is death, but inside is death. So this message is the purpose to unveil Christ. When veils of men's teachings were shutting away the Shekinah glory, when veils of men's doctrines were shutting away. But now it's the unveiling of God. The message is the voice of God in the end times. I know there are many voices, the voices of fashions, voice of politics, voice of churches, voice of philosophers, voice of unbelievers, and all those voices are swallowed by the super voice, the voice of Christ, voice of God. So always hear that voice. So every Christian should be reflecting the life of Christ. In your life, you don't have to reflect the life of another pastor, but reflect the life of Christ, because the message is a love letter. We read between the lines. We catch even the unsaid part. Don't let men's little barbed wires separate you from fellowship of saints of the living God, who are our brethren of like precious faith. The message did not come to separate brotherhood. The message did not come to make kicks and cans, or to make slogans that we are of the thunders, we are of the seals, the others are lost, we are in. The message came to unite the bride of Christ, and no man should disunite or fragment the body of Christ again, because those that know their God in the last times, they shall do exploits. We have the sheaf wave that is the wave before us in the supernatural life, in the power that God raised, in the standard, in the life of our prophet, in the life of Christ, because Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. When the sheaf wave is waved, it means all of us must reach that standard. It should not be the supernatural life of William Branham, the supernatural life of all the prophets, of all of Christ, and then the natural life of the believers today. But we must see all the quotations, all the powerful quotes raising to reality. We are not only supposed to quote, but to become quotes. So because the God of the Bible must raise from the messages, from the tapes, from the books, and must be seen. Who shall be Jesus to this world? It should be God with skin on again. It should be Elohim condescending into our lives, hiding in the bare skins of our lives. So the prophet says, we are not here to build an organization. I'm not here for that. Christ never sent me to build an organization. Christ sent me to build individuals to the stature of Jesus Christ, that they may become a powerhouse, a dwelling place of the Spirit, by his word. So individuals are built. When you are listening to the word, when you are listening to someone, when you are reading the Bible, when you are praying, when you are having an experience with God, you are being built in character, because you won't reign without character, but your character is being molded. When you are passing through trials, through the cauldrons of trials and temptations and the hot burning times of hardships, you are being molded in character as an individual to reflect the life of Christ, so that all powers that are in heaven are in your hand. You are now adopted. You are now the manifested sons of God. You are now the masterpiece. God can take broken pieces and make masterpieces. In the days of Luther, it was the feet. In the days of Wesley, it was the body. In the days of Pentecostals, it was the mouth as they were speaking in tongues. But now the headship and the intelligence is coming, and we are now hearing straight from the throne of God. So this is the hour of restoration. All what Adam lost is being restored to us. The third pool ministry, the power of the spoken word, that you can speak and go forward. You don't need to cry and complain about circumstances in your life. God has packed you rich with the power to speak the word and go forward. This is the time, not of manifestation of demons, but of manifestation of sons and daughters of God. Where were you when God laid the foundation of the world, and when sons and daughters of God shouted for joy? This is the dispensation of adoption, where our ranks we are given. In Christianity, you can't be in lower rank forever, but you have a rank that you can reach, a level and a sphere, a dimension that you can aim to, and you reach there. So the season of dynamics, the message introduces us not to words only, but in power and demonstration. The God of the Bible works, he puts dynamics upon the mechanics. It's not enough to have the message without the God of the message, to have the prophet without the God of the prophet, to follow a man of God without the God of the man, to carry the spoken word without the God of the spoken word. So he says, there was the time of the scotch card, then there was the time of the automobile, There was the time of the aeroplane. They are going higher and higher in science. And then now this time of the spacecraft. So spiritually, in the days of Luther there, it was the time of the Scotch cat. In the days of West, it was automobile. In the days of Pentecostal, they were now quite high. But now it's an astronaut edge where you have astronaut faith to rise above all unbelief, to rise above all powers of hell. And the message is not a museum to say, 1965, this happens, 1963, oh, this happened to Sister Eddie, this happened. It must happen to you. That power is available to those who are reaching out. So the faith, we have faith for the greater works. Greater works shall you do. So when the bride goes back to being the word bride, she will produce the very works that Christ produced. In other words, the same power of Christ will be manifested now in the bride of Christ. She is given the signet and authority that what she binds on earth is bound in heaven. So the message is to give us rapturing faith. Because faith is a revelation. When something is revealed to you, it's going to happen. Faith, when it goes above divine healing, above getting cars and houses, above getting maybe your desires of your heart, it reaches where it can transform your body and push you straight into the presence of God, where you see you are stepping into your perfect picture, because God looked at your perfect picture without blame, spot or wrinkle. He didn't look at you where you are, so he justified you. The bride of Christ is carrying the potentials of Christ. She has the harmony with the bridegroom. She's the queen of heaven. She's the living stones. And she's the temple. And she is the likened unto the pure gold. And she is the oddball. She is him. So we must live a lifestyle of the rapturable bride of Christ. In whatever you do, remain rapturable. When you are living your life, don't compromise. Don't allow unbelief. Don't allow viruses of faith. Remain rapturable, because we don't know any time the trumpet will sound. So when we believe the message, we are now a candidate of association with unseen world. We interact with the spiritual world. We are visited by angels. We are empowered by divine graces and divine attributes until the attributes of God are displayed in us. So the message is like the camels. When Rebecca, the bride, watered the camels, they carried her home. The message that you believe, the word of God that you believe, it will give you strength to overcome. It will give you power to rise to your heavenly home. So the message of the hour is tying the loose ends. All what the reformers were guessing at, they left threads of hanging things about the mysteries of the Bible. And then the message had to come in the purpose of the opening of the seven seals, the opening of the mysteries of God. It was the purpose of the opening of the seals was to call out a bride, to bring total restoration of everything that Adam lost, and to bring the book of redemption, the abstract title Deeds of Redemption, to bring them back to us so that we have all the powers that Adam lost and the chain of circumstances back to, and to turn the hearts of the children to the fathers, to bring rapturing faith and to anoint us for the job that we, the assignment that we have, and to bring the operation of the third pole ministry to expose the devil and his tactics, and to reveal Christ in our life, Christ in you, the hope of glory, to complete the threefold purpose of God in our life, and to finish the mystery of God, and to empower the bride. So we are empowered. You should not complain. You should not be wondering, yes, a wandering star, but it's to trigger the bride ministry to call, to eat the book so that the mysteries are now in you, encoding your behavior, encoding your words, to have the word in flesh again, to open a new dispensation of the fullness of the word of God. So the opening of the seals is the roll call of names. So when God, the mystery that you see, it calls into the kingdom. It's not just our literal names, but it's calling us to the body of Christ. It's like a Chinese laundry ticket. The part that you have in your life, the other part is in the throne of God. So the two pieces must join together. You and the word must dovetail together. The deep must call to the deep. When the spirit is saying, come, the bride must be saying, come. The potentials of the book are now echoing in you. In other words, the mind that was in Christ is now in you again. You are now connected You are reunited with Christ, and then the bride will have a ministry. When we see this, the stone where the sun had never shined, the mysteries of our time that help us. And when God in this message is building us through the word to the stage of a perfect man, adding faith, on faith, virtue, knowledge, temperance, patience, godliness, brotherly kindness, and the capstone of love. So the message trims us as the body. We cannot trim the capstone. We cannot trim the Holy Ghost of Christ. We trim our lives to match Christ. We see the coming back of the third full ministry again, speaking things into existence. In this climax or the earth's final hours, there are people almost everywhere whose hearts are all aflame. The same power that was running in Elijah is now running in Elisha. That's why the first miracle of Elisha was the last miracle of Elijah, the opening of the Jordan River, as you see in that video there, that the last miracle of Elijah, as I move, the last miracle of Elijah became the first miracle of Elisha. When the robe that was in Elijah dropped down, it means that the same power that was running in the mystery of the prophet's life, in the mystery of the life of the apostles, in the life of the prophets, in the life of Christ, must be seen. That same mantle must be seen in us. So the message reveals the future home of the heavenly bridegroom and the earthly bride. We come from God and we go back to God. This is the third exodus in the message of the hour. We are going back from Eden via Pentecost. So as John was weeping, because he didn't know that who will open the book, the lion says, the elder says, the lion of the tribe of Judah has prevailed to open the book. Now, the message is not only opening the mysteries of God, the host riders in the church, it also opens the mystery of your life. Why you passed through what you passed through, and the horse riders that were fighting in your life, it exposes the powers of Satan that were rising in your life. It also shows the power of Christ triumphing and ruling your life. So the mysteries and the seals of your life as an individual must also be open, because we are not only talking about the seals in the church being open, but the seals and the mysteries of your life must be revealed, and the same Christ who prevailed will prevail in your life. Surely the Lord does nothing, but he reveals his secrets to his servants, the prophets. So we have an open book. We are not preaching from a closed book. We have the whole plan of God, plan of redemption is open now. And there is going to be a certain amount of people that's predestinated to hear that message, and they will follow it. Even if you don't understand everything of it, there is something in you that amends it. There is something in you that says, this is nothing but the truth. So when you believe it, the miracles, the supernatural become a regular routine. In other words, every day with Jesus, you see miracles. You see this healing there, deliverance there, providence there. Every day you are seeing something from above operating in your life. So them tapes will fall in the right hands of the predestinated seed of God. And wherever the equals are, they will follow that fold, whether it comes by tap, whether it comes by the word of a testimony, the equals will follow it to its headquarters. So it's the message has moved us from head knowledge to revelation, from churchianity to Christianity, from bastard children to sons and daughters of God, from being the church to being the bride of Christ, from deception to the truth, from bastard children to sons and daughters of God, from amnesia to consciousness. So the Gentiles' message started by visitation of the pillar of fire. When the pillar of fire visited Paul, there was the pillar of fire that came. So it ends the same way. It started with the pure word in the days of Paul. It ends with the pure and adulterated, unhybridized word of God with the same results, same anointing, same power, same emphasis, and same preaching, same presence of God, no matter where the person is that is a believer. God in some way will get the true message to them, just as certain as he is God. Even if you are in a place where there is no message church, but God in some way will get the true message to you. Remember when Matopo Church started, It's just a paper of our end time signs that a sister picked, just one paper of the whole book, and it had four numbers, and she called, and God in some way will get the true message to you. Whether you're in a bus and you pick the book, whether you're in a surgery and you pick a book, God in some way will get the true message to you. We are supposed to be light to this age, manifesting the gospel. So you are the lights. Don't join darkness. Don't be conformed to this world. Don't be under pressure to become like them of this world. God is, there's the you group and the them group. God says, I send you, not them. Elijah the prophet is sending you the Holy Spirit. He's sending you the power of the gospel. So don't conform to the world. When a banana is among mangoes, even if there are a million mangoes and you have one seed of a banana, it won't be under pressure to become a mango. So I'm duty bound to this message. Now, your life can make people hate the message or like it, just by the way you live your life. We've got to be enthused with this message. If you are not enthused, then there's something wrong. You should be happy and content. Don't eat in garbage bins when the threshing floors and are overspilling with wine and oil, everything. It's a, you know, in the harvest time, no one is hungry and no one eats, everyone eats according. If you want to eat much, you eat much because no one will stop you when there's plenty. This message that I'm preaching is the true message of this day. I'm putting you in the same place that I am because you are just as much into it as I am. You are the messengers of the same message. So all of you are torchbearers. All of you, your life is under the eyes of your neighbors, under the eyes of your boss at work. Your influence will cause them to come in or to hate the message. But if you have received the Holy Spirit, then you are a candidate of association with angelic beings. Every day you must venture into supernatural. There should be no limit in what you can venture into. So the message is the former and latter rain coming again. There was the former rain, which was the teaching rain, more. Then there's the latter rain, which is the manifestation of what was planted. What was taught must be manifested. When we teach healing, there must be a sign of healing. When we teach the rapture, there must be something that is the earnest, which is the healing of our bodies, showing that our bodies shall be changed. When we teach a new birth, we should see a change of life of the people. When we teach about the blessings of God, we should see the people blessed by God. There should be the planting of the seed of the word and also the manifestation of what is being taught. This message is the invisible union of Christ and his church. We are united right now. This is the bride's revival. It's the revival of the just. We are connected to a supernatural source. As I'm finishing now, the message is a perfect realization of what God is doing in this hour. God is doing a work in this hour. Be part of that work. God is changing people in this hour. God is recruiting an army in this hour. God is showing the climax of the gospel with the climax of the supernatural, climax of the vindications. Be part of that. So the message of the message is the Holy Ghost baptism. So the principal theme of the message, Jesus Christ is the same in power, in word, in principles, yesterday, today, and forever. We are here to reflect Christ and to see the mystery of God and the mystery of who you are in Christ. Because when you start knowing who you are, when you start knowing him, you start knowing who you are. So it's taking us back to the original word. It's taking us to total restoration. It's a message of grace. It is the voice of God in the end times. It is the divine revelation of God. So the God of the message will answer his people. Those who are believing the message, God will always follow the message to bring it to come to pass. As I'm closing now, as I'm about to pray, I believe that that same angel that was visiting the prophet is there to visit you. That same angel that will visit those who believe and follow their neighborhood is there to visit you. That same God who provided is there to provide for you. That same God who descends, he is knowing what you are believing. As you are, I see you are typing amen there and you are believing for something. God knows exactly. He still descends. The same Holy Spirit that is with us is not an inferior type of Holy Spirit. It's the same Holy Spirit. As I see Favourite, they is watching from Cape Town, Asanda from South Africa, Petronella Nduru from Harare, and Wilfred Nkata, and Gift, and Darlington. Now, God knows all your needs. Mavis, God bless you, and Jane, God bless you, Kutai. Now, the God that we worship is a God who knows all the mysteries of our life. He knows your desires and unspoken desires before you even speak, before you even ask. He says, it shall come to pass in the last days that before they ask, I shall hear, I shall answer them. Now, many critics may rise, whether it's seeking the truth or this, whatever, they may rise and try to fight this message. But brother, the vindications of this message are unstoppable because the message is continuing. Whatever, as they are speaking about this and that, that same God is busy vindicating the message, busy fighting for those who believe. I've seen massive testimonies of healing, even in the times of lockdowns, when it looked like the church is impaired, the Holy Spirit was not impaired. In the online services, I've seen massive testimonies of the hand of God, the unseen hand that moves even on Facebook and YouTube. It has no limit. That hand can touch you today. That hand can heal you today. As we are about to pray, just connect to God in your heart and say, Lord, I believe this message. And I believe the angel of the Lord follows those that believe. Those who, even Peter said, we have not followed cunningly devised fables when we believe this message, because we heard that voice speaking in the mountain. If you have never met that God, if you have never had that experience that can settle your faith, so that no one can move you in and out of the message. But that experience that makes you say, I know who I believed. That makes you say, it's not a guess so. I know that I know that I know. God is able to see where you are. Whatever nation, whatever country you are in, God is able to visit you. God is able to touch you. God is able to forgive you. God is able, through the fountain filled with blood, to cleanse you, to remove the desires of sin, to break the yoke of sin, to break the yoke of sickness. Because wherever this message is preached, it is followed by results. It is followed by the supernatural. It is followed by the anointing. It's not a message of just do's and don'ts or arguments of seals, whether open or not, but rather it's a message of the presence of God. He is here today to answer your need today. God can prove himself to you. If you're here and maybe you just stuck at in and logged in and you have never heard this message, today is your day to be born again. You can give your life to Christ and you'll never regret it. Christ is the master strategist. He can pick the pieces of your life and make something beautiful. Those who are weary, those who are almost giving up, cheer, my brother, because there is a hand that can take over in your life. That message that we received, that message that is the supernatural, that supernatural is with us today. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, as your children are expecting and they are praying and they are desiring, Lord Father, a visitation from you. They are saying, where is the God of Elijah? Where is the God of the message? Where is the God that heals? Where is the God of the Bible? I believe these are Bible days again, oh Lord Father, because your presence is here, Lord Father, to transform your people, Lord Father, to break the yoke of sin, to break, Father, all evil living, and to make all things new again by the power of your blood, by the power of your Holy Spirit. May you take all vilest offenders. May you take all sinners today, Lord Father, and plunge them in the blood of the Lamb. Father, wash them. Wash us until we are clean. Lord Father, until we don't want to sin anymore. In that sea of forgetfulness, may you bury all sins of your children, Father. Maybe they are somewhere uncertain about tomorrow. Maybe they are burdens about this life, oh Lord Father. They don't know whether they will get money for exams. And some, Lord Father, are wanting to write their exams. Some, Lord Father, are waiting for results. Some, all the needs that they can ever have. Some are having pressures financial. Some are having pressures, Father, because of barrenness. They want children. Some are looking to you, Lord Father, from whence cometh their help. They are saying, Lord, I have a prayer request. I've written down my request and I'm still waiting for a God who cannot never disappoint me. Father, as they are waiting, as they are looking to you, Father, send your answer on the wings of a snow-white dove. May you remember them, Father, and even this evening, may you visit them mightily through your power, through your anointing, and bring things that they've hoped for, what they've always hoped for. Father, may they see it materializing and manifesting, because this is that time, Father, of that climax of the gospel, where, Lord Father, you are pouring your spirit like never before in the battlefield where we are in, Lord Father, when the enemy is rising from left, right, and center. We know, Lord Father, there is more with us than with the enemy, and we shall overcome. We shall break every enemy under our feet. And Father, we are blessed. I know, Father, you have already answered your children. In this time, I say, may you bless them and follow them and encourage them with something supernatural in their life, in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. I see Brother Alfred Matanga, Rutendo Marufu, Fred Chireka, Mfundisi, God bless you. Tomorrow, by the grace of God, I must be in South Africa, God allowing, and it's been long, and I think this year I've not been to South Africa, so I'm overjoyed that I'll be meeting you friends, those who are in Joburg. I'll be preaching at UofL. I see Selo and Chari Chirisere and Rutendo and Eliu, Turkey, yes, Eliu. I've penciled that around 15 June, I should be coming to Turkey, and I'll be happy to. I know my program will be tight, but I know I will get time to greet the saints there by the grace of God. And those who are in Cyprus, by the 20th of June, I should be in Cyprus as you pray for me. Caleb Chitio, God bless you right there. Is it in Malaysia? God bless you. Yes, Darlington and Catherine, Jane, and Godfrey, all of you saints, may the Lord answer you. Could Zanai Muchenje and Pilan, God bless you saints. Pray for me. I'll be traveling tomorrow by the grace of God. I know you'll be with me in prayers. I always pray for you. So always you pray for me as I pray for you. Let's keep under expectation. We know God is fixing to do great thing, and the rapture is at hand. So until we meet, now our youths, we remind you that we'll be having Pastor Madiba on the 15th of June. Then we'll also be having Dr. Maduka on the 17th of July. Then one of these Fridays, I will tell you which Friday we'll be having Pastor Dele. So we are blessed with the fivefold ministry that will be helping us. So friends, until we meet, God be with you. Until we meet again, amen.